In this video, we're going to go through the anatomy and physiology of taste and smell. So the first one on our list, smell, which you can also call olfaction, is a sort of a weird hybrid between digestive system and nervous system, because they obviously are nervous tissue, but they're communicating so much important information to the digestive tract, given that these senses activate the stomach, they turn on the digestive response. It makes sense to think about them in that context. So, anatomy. The first thing is, this olfactory bulb is a meeting between two sets of neurons. The first is the neurons that actually make up the olfactory nerve itself. Remember, this is cranial nerve number one. It's entirely sensory. And so the tips of these olfactory nerves, that is where you find all of your actual sensory receptors that are carrying information about smell. So we would have air containing, you know, whatever aerosolized molecules are in what you're smelling, whether it's from, you know, food that's sitting in front of you or gasoline at a gas station. Whatever you smell has to have molecules that enter your nasal cavity, dissolve in the liquid, the mucus that's surrounding those olfactory nerves, and bind to receptors. Those receptors will start sending action potentials back towards the olfactory bulb. And then the neurons that actually make their way back to the brain, we call those the olfactory tract, right? So if you zoom in and look a little closer, this is what an illustration of that tissue would look like, right? Here's the ethmoid bone that separates the brain from the nasal cavity. These are our actual olfactory receptors. And so this thin layer of mucus down here and all of these olfactory cilia, right, those cilia, you know, sort of dangling down through the epithelium of the respiratory, upper respiratory tract, that's where you find actual receptors. And when molecules that enter the air dissolve in that mucus, they'll bind receptors, and we're getting signals, right, action potentials being sent, right, up these axons of the optic nerve, and they synapse with these mitral cells in the olfactory bulb. Those bits of information are now heading back to the brain, to the CNS, to be interpreted. Right? And what makes smell a bit complicated is humans can distinguish thousands, tens of thousands. Some people have argued potentially hundreds of thousands of different smells if we were exposed to them. Now, the catch is you don't have tens of thousands of receptors. You only have about 400 different receptor types. The catch is, when you smell something, it's almost always a complex mixture. Like, imagine smelling a cup of coffee. Coffee isn't just a single molecule. And so the molecules in your coffee are going to activate a different combination of receptors. And what your brain effectively does is, it keeps a map so that it knows which receptor is found on which sensory neuron, and they should each only express one. And so the way it works is, out of those 400 different receptors, everything that you recognize as a smell is activating a particular combination of those receptors, and your brain has to keep track of which ones are which so that it knows which combination you're smelling, and then you can store that combination as a memory so that you know what that same smell is the next time you encounter it. All right. The other thing that's sort of unique to both smell and temperature, or sorry, smell and taste, is these neurons are exposed to a lot of different environmental stresses, like changes in temperature, infections, anything toxic that you might get in your oral or nasal cavity. And so those olfactory receptors, they die off and they have to be replaced. That can sometimes lead to errors, because if your brain replaces the neuron but doesn't fix it by adding the exact same receptor that the original cell had, the brain loses track of that map. That's why older people tend to eventually have their sense of taste and smell fade over time, because they start to get mixed up in that pathway. All right, in taste, we see something similar, but the anatomy is a different setup. So the first thing to point out is, if you look closely at someone's tongue, you'll see bumps on the tongue that can be seen with the naked eye. Those bumps we call papilla. And then buried deep within papilla are small microscopic structures that you would call a taste bud. So you can't see taste buds, but you can see papilla, and one papilla might contain, several dozen to even several hundred taste buds. And then each taste bud has to have an opening, a little crevice, right, that leads down into the taste bud so that the fluid from your saliva can carry food molecules that you're tasting and actually make contact with those receptors. Okay, so this is now an illustrated zoom in on one taste bud, and each of these receptors within it you would call a taste cell or a gustatory cell. And they have these little hairs or cilia on top of them, very similar to the ones in the nasal cavity for smell, because those things increase surface area. They allow you to put more receptors in. That makes your senses more sensitive. So you have about 10,000 taste buds that are covering mostly the surface of the tongue, but some of them on the surrounding structures like the cheeks and the epiglottis. And each taste cell generally carries information about a specific taste. So either sweet or salty or sour, etc. And so it's just like smell. Your brain has to keep a map of which taste bud corresponds to which type of taste. That way they're paired together and your brain knows when each certain molecule happens to be inside your mouth. Okay, so this zoomed in view shows you a little bit better. This is your oral cavity. This is where your layer of fluid or saliva would be. And whatever molecules are in the food that you just ate are going to have to enter that taste pore. And these little cilia are where the receptors would be. If a molecule binds a receptor that it matches, you stimulate one of these taste cells, and then they're going to send information back the nerve that they're connected to, right? One of the cranial nerves that carries taste information. And just like with smell, these cells have turnover, right? They divide every week or so and have to be replaced. Again, if that happens too fast or too haphazardly, your brain will lose track of the map and it won't know which cells are which. That's part of a person, developing a more vague, sense of taste over time, especially with age. All right, so let's talk taste. There are five tastes that everyone thoroughly agrees on. There are a few others that are sort of question marks, but they all respond to a certain kind of molecule. So sweet receptors detect sugars like sucrose or fructose or glucose and artificial sweeteners. Umami detects amino acids. And remember, amino acids are just the molecules that proteins are built out of. So we call umami savory. Umami is just the Japanese word for savory because it was discovered by a Japanese researcher. And that's why people will add things like monosodium glutamate or MSG to foods, is it because it gives them an extra savory sort of taste. Bitter receptors tend to respond to a group of molecules called alkaloids. They're generally things that are toxic or dangerous. And so think of bitter components as generally like bacterial waste, things from spoiled food, right? Salty is sensing ions, mostly sodium, but other ones like potassium can have a minor effect. And sour taste is hydrogen ions. Remember, hydrogen ions are what we're measuring in pH. And so sour taste really means acid. That's why citric acid from citrus fruits like lemons and limes have a sour taste because they lower the pH of your saliva. Okay, follow up to this. These three senses, sweet, umami, and bitter, use G protein linked receptors that activate like a cell signaling cascade inside the taste cell. Salty and sour, they don't really need a receptor. Those receptors are ion channels themselves. And so, if sodium flows through the salty channel, you taste salt. And if hydrogen ions flow through the sour channel, you taste sour or acid. The reason this works is sodium and hydrogen are both positive ions. So, if they flow into the cell depolarizes and gets activated. Another important thing to point out is that some receptors, like sweet, and umami, there's only one receptor and that's it, right? So sweet and umami, one receptor, they detect a pretty limited number of molecules. So for sweet receptors, just different sugars, glucose, sucrose, fructose. And so we would say that these two receptor types detect a low diversity of molecules, just a couple different sugars or amino acids. Bitter receptors have 25 different receptors, right? The reason for that is they detect a very high diversity of molecules. The reason is there are many, many different toxic substances, not just one small family like with sugars. And so you have to be able to detect all sorts of different things that might be harmful so your brain can register as having a bitter sense of taste, right? The other thing to think about is the concept of sensitivity, right? Sensitivity asks how much stimulus does it take to activate the receptor? And sweet and umami receptors tend to have very low sensitivity, meaning it takes a lot of sugar for something to taste sweet. Right? If you have a glass of unsweetened iced tea and you want to sweeten it up, you might be adding grams of sugar to that drink. Bitter taste receptors are very high sensitivity. That just means a really small quantity of bitter compounds or molecules can activate the receptor and make something taste bitter. That makes sense because you want to avoid bitter things, they might be dangerous. And so you intentionally make these receptors low sensitivity because your brain wants you to eat these things. So it takes a lot to activate them and get the sensation that you're looking for. With bitter, we want high sensitivity because you want to avoid even small quantities of things that might be dangerous. All right, so if we look at what's happening in an actual taste cell, this is showing you your different options. Sweet, bitter, and umami compounds bind to these G protein linked receptors. That's this guy. And eventually that leads to calcium flowing into the cell. That releases neurotransmitters on a nerve, right? Any of these cranial nerves that carry taste information, and the info goes back to the brain. Acids and salts, remember, those are ion channels. So the ions directly diffuse through the channel. Same end result, their pathways merge. And you get the release of calcium and the release of neurotransmitters. And so, in either case, we're getting action potentials in cranial nerves that lead back to the brain. They only differ in the type of receptor that they activate in the taste cell itself. Okay, a few other small things to add on. One is there are probably more than five tastes. There's pretty good evidence that we can taste fat to some degree. It's not as distinct as the others, but there are receptors for fatty acids on the tongue. There's also some evidence that people and animals may be able to taste calcium, although it may be a subconscious thing as a way for us to crave high calcium foods if the body's low on calcium and bone tissue. So those are probably additional tastes, but they sometimes get left out of textbooks. There are also other things that affect taste indirectly, like capsaicin, which is the molecule that gives spicy peppers their spice. They give the false sense of heat because they activate heat or pain receptors indirectly, kind of like a drug. And so that's not truly taste, but it's related. And temperature, remember, also has a big impact on taste and smell because as temperature goes up, it releases more molecules from the food that can dissolve in saliva or even be vaporized and enter the nasal cavity. So all of these things pool together to give the combined effect of flavor, which is really just taste plus smell mixed together equals flavor of food because normally you're getting both of those things at the same time. All right, hope this was helpful. The next video in the playlist is going to cover a few digestive pathologies, so follow along. As always, the videos make more sense if you watch them in sequence.